Hello and welcome. In this video, we are going to summarize all the important methods that are covered in a complex analysis course regarding complex integration. We will cover the main idea behind each method, the conditions that need to be fulfilled to be able to use it, and also when you're supposed to maybe choose one method over another. And we're going to do all of this in just around 10 minutes. So let's get going. The main methods introduced in the course to solve contour integrals are the following. The first method is called parametrization, but I also like to call it the brute force method, since the calculations will take some time to do, but it will probably still work when all other methods fail. You can only use this method if you are able to parametrize the contour in question, so in short you need to be able to describe the contour gamma with some function c of t. And this method is therefore mostly used when dealing with contours that are easy to parametrize, like lines or circles for example. And it is quickly replaced by other methods later on in the course, when we start to get contours like loops that are much harder to describe with some function. A method that instead do not really care about the contour in question is our next method, the independence of path, which you might know better under the name the fundamental theorem of calculus. This method can only be used when you're dealing with a function that has an antiderivative on the contour gamma. But if this is true, then the method tells us that the integral will only be determined by the start and end points, and the path the contour takes between these two points is not important. So for example, two different contours will give us the same result as long as we have the same start and end points. So these two for example. And if we are dealing with a loop, then the integral will always be equal to zero, since a loop always starts and ends at the same point. This result also corresponds to the main findings of our next method. Cauchy's integral theorem states that the integral for some function f along some loop gamma is always going to be equal to zero, as long as the function f is analytic on and inside the contour gamma. But let's say that the function f is analytic everywhere inside of gamma except at one point. What are we going to do then? We are of course going to use our next method called Cauchy's integral formula. This method can easily handle one singularity inside of a contour gamma. The only thing we need to do to use it is to make sure to rewrite the integrand so that it is written on this form here with the singularity in the denominator. Since by doing this we have a singularity inside of gamma for the integrand, but not for function f itself, which is the important part, since the function f needs to be analytic on and inside of gamma for us to be able to use this method. The last method is called Cauchy's residue theorem, and this method is able to handle any number of singularities inside of a contour gamma, and is therefore in most cases the one method to choose when dealing with singularities. It works by taking the sum of all the residues evaluated at the singularities, and the only requirement for this to work is that the function f needs to be analytic on and inside of gamma, except at the singularities of course. So to quickly recap, the last three methods here are kind of similar, right? But they are used in different scenarios. You are going to want to choose Cauchy's integral theorem if you don't have any singularities. But you can choose either Cauchy's integral formula or Cauchy's residue theorem if you are dealing with one singularity. I, for example, use Cauchy's residue theorem in nearly all cases, except when I'm dealing with a singularity with an order of 2 or higher. But if you have 2 or more singularities, then you are always going to want to use Cauchy's residue theorem. That was all the main methods, but there are still other good tools introduced in the course that you are going to need to include in your toolbox if you are going to be able to solve all the different kinds of integrals. The two standard rules are the following. First off, if you are able to split a contour up into two parts, then the integral along the contour will be equal to the sum of the integral along the two parts. And this is really useful, for example, when trying to parametrize this contour here. Because if we start by splitting it up into two lines instead, then we can just parametrize each line one at a time, which will be much easier to do then trying to find a function that describes the whole contour. This rule is also quite useful when we're dealing with loops, since any loop is just a combination of a number of simple closed contours. So instead of trying to solve the integral for a loop, we can instead solve it for each underlying simple closed contour that makes up a loop. The second rule is that if you are able to rewrite the function as the sum of two other functions, then the integral for a function that we started with will be equal to the sum of integrals for these two other functions. Another good tool to know is the deformation of contour method, also known as the deformation invariance theorem. This theorem only works when you are dealing with loops, but it tells us that two integrals are equal if the loops can be continuously deformed into one another. This is really useful when you are dealing with some complicated contour, since then you can just deform it into something more manageable, and then solve the integral along that contour instead. The ML-inequality, also known as the estimation lemma, is used to set the upper bound for an integral. It states that the absolute value of an integral will always be equal or lesser than some value m, which denotes some upper bound of the absolute value of a function f on the contour gamma, times l, which is the arc length of a contour gamma. Most of the time we use this method when we know that the right-hand side of this expression approaches zero, since then the integral also must be equal to zero. This method is also most of the time used hand-in-hand with the triangle inequality, which describes the relationship between the distances created by two vectors, in this case the two complex numbers c1 and c2. If you understand all of these methods, then you have all the necessary tools to solve any complex integration problem in this course. But the main challenge most of the time is to be able to pick the right method for each different case, and that is why I created this flowchart here. And next time I will show you how to use it, so that you are able to pick the right method each time, and therefore be able to solve any integral in complex analysis. So until next time, thanks for watching.